you waiting. Thank you for your patience. Now, without any further delay, I would like to call upon our president of Tri Chennai, Mr. B. Shankar, over to the stage and talk for a few minutes.
I want to thank you all for registering for TICON and thereby coming for this wonderful pre-TICON event. And after the event, you will go back and you will feel enthused to come for the rest of TICON. Please spread the word. It is going to be a very different event this time. And we do have a small window open till the 17th to get a good registration package. So that was the first thing. Second thing is for those who, how many are members here, how many are not members? Members, raising hands. Non-members, please raise your hands. You should become members, and I'll tell you why. We will shortly announce the. See, one of the things that we have always wanted to do is to provide a proper mentor-mentee connection platform. Ideally, something that is technologically good, current, up to date, which enables you to discover mentors. To look at the number of mentors, look at their profiles and decide who's most appropriate to you, and then reach out to them and seek a request. We've just completed billing that, and we've had a few requests already online. And later today, the members will be sent an email package by the secretariat telling you how exactly to use the Mentor Connect facility online on the site. So we look forward. This has been an ask for a long time. So I will be disappointed if I do not get totally flooded with mentorship requests over the next few days. Of course, it is Chandu's job to introduce Girish. He's got a good job. But I will say that the moment I talked to Girish and said, Girish, will you come and spend some time here? He did not even think twice. He just said, of course, for time, for entrepreneurship. So, Girish, thank you very much. Chandu, Girish.
Now I would like to introduce Mr. Chandu Nayak. He is an entrepreneur, advisor and facilitator, and he is also an investor. Mr. Chandu has over 30 years of experience in industry, consultancy, media and information services. A co-founder of Scope E-Knowledge Center, a pioneering knowledge process outsourcing company that has scaled up to 1,000 people before its exit. Now I would like to call upon Mr. Chandu over to his. Thank you.
How many of you have not heard of Girish Mathrubhudam in this hall? The one gentleman. Okay, I think somebody get him a help desk, please. Okay, I'll just tell you a few words about Girish for those of you who don't know, but I'll also give you some numbers to illustrate what personality we're going to be speaking to. Everybody probably knows him, knows of him as the founder, or co-founder, really, of Freshdesk. Now it's called Freshworks. So no longer Freshdesk, but Freshworks. And he is a Shastra Engineering College product, a Trichy boy, so to speak, who today likes to eat papaya. Not because the monkeys in his neighborhood used to eat, but because that's the only fruit and thing his doctor allows him to eat. Okay? I can pull Girish's leg because I've done this introduction in different forms in different ways. So he has worked on this thing about a help desk for a very long time now. And he was earlier in Zoho, and before that he was briefly in HCL Cisco also, which he didn't last very long. And it is in Zoho that he cut his teeth. But people in Zoho will say that he was always very impatient. He was thinking, why should you spend 5 years doing something that can be done in 5 months? So which is why finally he got out on his own, much to the horror of his wife Shobha, who stopped cooking when he told her the news, because they had EMAs and all, you know. So the classic good old South Indian mentality. But let's see where he is today. Today he has 130,000 customers. Okay, the least I think probably in India. So he's really a global SaaS company. Estimated revenues, don't kill me, okay, Girish. estimated revenues of about 70 million, a valuation probably in the vicinity of 750 million, funds raised of about 149, close to 150 million, and the aim, which is what should make all of us in Chennai proud, the aim is to be 1 billion in the next 1 year and be the first $2 billion tech IPO product company from out of India. So, we are going to be talking to Girish, and I don't want to hog the stage, so Girish, please come over and let's understand. Okay, so let me get straight to the chase, okay, cut straight to the chase. One of the things, Girish, that distinguishes your company, or rather, doesn't distinguish your company, you know. I remember you mentioning in an interview, a lot of people here, you know, we have been always told you must have something very different, very unique. But you know, when Girish started his help desk, if I'm not mistaken, you were the 605th help desk in the world. So for an audience like this, who's being told you must be differentiated, you must be unique, you must, you know, go into a white space, how did you build Freshdesk, which was the 605th help desk in the world, into where it is today?
So before I answer, again, Chandu is treating this like a Big Boss episode where he's continuing from the last session. So if any of you are not able to get where his references are coming from about Papaya or the 605th help desk, these were interviews that he did. So before I start, I'll also tell you that IIT Madras Research Park, it's not my phone, it's in airplane mode.
No, wait, I'll do one thing. I'll probably switch this off.
So, see, IIT Madras Research Park was actually the first place where we came, I think in 2010 or 2011, when we were in a small office in Kittatalai and office space that we actually came. I was telling some of my friends here that 2010-11 startups weren't so cool. Chennai was definitely not cool. I used to beg everybody, including TAI, including NASCOM and the RTBI here, just for space. Like we didn't want to stay in Kittatalai. We wanted a proper office space where we can attract employees, etc. And we couldn't get in here because there were demands beyond rent, you also have to take classes for students or give them some credits. And as a startup, we didn't have all the people or the resources to do all of them. So we thought, okay, we'll go somewhere else. So this is the history behind this building and Freshdesk. So coming back to answering this question, see, I in 2004, when I was working at Zoho, we wanted to build a product called Service Desk Plus, Manage Engine Service Desk Plus. So at that point of time, my boss and mentor, Kumar Vembu, actually told me, Girish, do you know there are 600 help desks in the world? Like, there was a website, it's still there today, called helpdesks.com. And you can go there and search all the 600 help desks. So really, Chandu is saying 605 because I built 4 help desks before Freshdesk. So we actually built a product out of Chennai, which is very, very successful, one of the most successful products for Zoho, probably somewhere in the $50 to $100 million of revenue. And so I think number one, there is so much truth in Steve Jobs' statement, stay hungry, stay foolish, right? If you just are foolish enough to believe that you can come as the 601st help desk and still do a good job and win, I think that's what we realized. And today I am able to articulate the differentiation better. Even when I started Freshdesk, I also thought, in fact, I thought who's going to fund the help desk, right? VC, so I was not thinking about VC funding because help desk is boring. So I thought, let's stick to what we know and we'll build that. But I can articulate the reason better today. See, we all think about innovation in product or innovation in features. There is or disruption in technology or disruption in product. There is also business model disruption. So this is what helped us in Freshdesk. If you look at most of the US software companies, see, most of the product companies are all based in the US. Very, very few product companies, software product companies, are outside of US. Even the successful ones like Atlassian from Australia or many of the European companies or SAP, they all move to the US and start a big operation in the US also. The fundamental business model differentiation that we figured out, which I am able to articulate better today, which I was not able to articulate 6 years ago, is it is very, very hard for a US company to profitably serve the SMB market. So number one, 10 years ago when you were selling on-premise software, the cost of the software used to be $100,000 or $200,000. A US salesperson will not meet a customer and sell if it is less than $50,000 deal size, because it doesn't make sense. Also, the SMBs are very hard to reach. It's like chasing rabbits. We call it chasing rabbits. So there was no viable business model to sell to the SMB. So what changed in the last 10 years? So number one, on one side, software as a service or SaaS brought down the cost of ownership. So you don't have to spend $100,000. You can spend $200 a month or $100 a month to buy software. So it became like a EMI business. So we are not in software business, we are in EMI business. That's what I joke. So like a finance company. So SMB customers can now pay $100 or $200 per month and get software. On the other hand, with thanks to Google AdWords and other online marketing, it is possible to generate leads online. Now these two, or sell across the internet, sell via phone. If somebody is going to pay you $100 or $200, they are not going to expect you to come with a suit and visit you and make a presentation. So the convergence of these two things really made it possible for us to profitably sell to the long tail of the global SMB. That is one of the reasons why we call it as a business model disruption, which even today exists. And this is what I keep telling wherever I go. I open up the Freshworks playbook and tell, I'm telling NASCOM, I'm telling iSpirit that this is the India playbook. It's not for Freshworks only. If we want a lot more software product companies out of India, this opportunity is available for all of us. And we need to build product companies that are catering to different markets, either horizontal or vertical, could be niche. Those are all business model decisions, but you can disrupt traditional expensive enterprise software and target the SMB and mid-market. So in simple analogy terms, I'll tell you, how many of you here don't have an iPhone, but have a OnePlus or a Xiaomi or a decent Android phone at 30,000 rupees, right? So that is exactly the business model. See, iPhone is great for the US market because there it is priced at $200 or $100 and people don't pay for it. In India, there aren't many people, or not only India, around the world, there are so many customers who can't pay like $700 or $800 for an iPhone. And we are not talking about cheap, crappy products here. We're talking about, when I say Xiaomi or OnePlus, I'm actually saying it with a lot of respect because these companies bring top of the line features, excellent hardware, in some cases better than iPhone, the hardware specs are, but the price point is 30,000-35,000 rupees, which opens up a different market segment. Now that is the opportunity for Indian software products, not cheap crappy products. Nobody will buy a crappy phone, right? Meaning maybe the not so informed buyer will buy it, or you don't have money, so you have to buy something for 4,000 or 5,000 rupees, that is the crappy product. So if you can build good product and disrupt the market leader, we have a great option in India. Sorry for the long answer, but I thought
it's very useful to get a context of what happened. Now, one of the things that amazes people is you started really in 2010. The product really came out in 2011 almost. And your first funding in one survey is that Microsoft BizSpark, $40,000 or some such thing. In a span of just about 6 years, zooming in one sense, you know, like what Vinod Kambli said about Sachin Tendulkar. He took the elevator, I took the staircase. So somewhere, tell us, you know, one of the questions that has come from the audience through earlier this. When you started Freshdesk, how many years did you really expect for Freshdesk to become of a certain size? And when did you start touching those timelines, and what really was the expectation and reality, you know, mismatch or gap? So can you just throw some light on it?
Okay. See, I will be very honest and tell you that if I tell you that I had imagined all of this will happen, I'll be lying. This is beyond whatever journey I'm going through. It's beyond the wildest of my dreams. Like any naive entrepreneur who starts, we were six people, okay, and most of us, me and my co-founder Shan did not take a salary. The other four who were making 10 lakhs in their previous job had joined us for around ₹45,000 a month. So we were six people. So I thought we will somehow come to a revenue of $10,000 per month. Our complete office expense including salary was $5,000. So we'll become profitable and then we can start hiring employees. This was the thought process. Also, what I really liked about my journey was, I was not afraid of failure, because Sisiri Vembu used to tell me, Girish, it's okay to be unemployed, it's not okay to be unemployable. So I was always confident that if things don't work out, we'll try for 12 months, 18 months or 24 months. If things don't work out, I told my team also, I will type a resume and find a job and I'll hire you guys. So that was the plan B. That is, if we'll all go back to work. We knew that we can get work. So that was the get employment. So, but what happened along the journey was, the first time when Microsoft BizSpark Award happened, that was the first time we believed that somebody sitting in Keerkatlai and building software for the world, we were foolish enough to do that. And I was also able to convince four other people apart from my co-founder to believe in my dream and join me. So the first time when somebody like Microsoft gave us $40,000 as a price-free money, so that was when I thought, okay, maybe we are on to something. And also in that meeting, I saw other entrepreneurs also, and I thought, okay, so see, when you haven't met anybody, when you're sitting in a room and building a product, you don't know how is the ecosystem. There's no ecosystem in Chennai, right? In 2010, there was no startup ecosystem in Chennai. So first time we went to Bangalore and saw this, okay, I saw a lot of entrepreneurs who were all very, talking very tech terms. So this event happened in a big hotel with 450 people in the audience. There were like VCs in the jury, but most of the entrepreneurs were coming and just pitching their product and talking very technically. Now, I had an unfair advantage that I had spent 10 years at Zoho, and most of that 10 years I had been traveling and I know how to speak and tell a story. So in fact, I broke all the rules of the competition but told a good story, and that's why we won actually. But Microsoft giving us the prize gave us the validation and belief that, hey, maybe we are on to something. So we won $40,000 free money, and so that's when we thought, okay, and VC Axel was also part of the jury. So we got a term sheet for $1 million because of that event. So then we said, okay, if you have $1 million, now the honest thought that was going in my mind at that point of time, I haven't told this to anybody, in 2011 was, நம்ம எடுத்த ரிஸ்க் கூட நம்ம மேல வேற யாரும் பெருசா ரிஸ்க் எடுத்துட்டாங்க. So I come from a middle class family and I've never saved a lot of money. So most of the time you come to the end of the month, you find your bank account going low and so on. So, and when somebody gives you like a 5 crore, 6 crore check, that was more than the risk that I had taken in my life in quitting the job, right? Because, so that was the feeling. But as things moved on, the ambition started getting bigger and bigger. So, but I think I can keep talking, but I'll let Chandu.
You know, I think anybody would say that this year's theme of Tycon is dream, dare, do. The reason for this theme are folks like him. Okay, because he started off with just a small dream, okay. He dared. But the do is the most important part. And I think that's what I want to just focus a little on. One of the things I want to figure out is, you know, one of the things you keep talking about here and there at SASEX, at product nation, etc., is that it's possible to build a global product from out of India. Entrepreneurs here are not ambitious enough, are not looking at the global scale or the global orient, they're not globally oriented enough. What lessons you want to quickly give folks here to say, boss, this is what you can do to build a global product?
Okay. See, let's split it into two or three things. Okay. First is, before you can build a global product, you have to build a product. Right? So which has to be useful for somebody. So that itself, so many entrepreneurs struggle there, right? In India, especially if you're selling to Indian customers, before you can attempt to build product, you are called. Like, for example, my first customer came from Australia. It was Atwell College. He came to the website through an online ad, spent 2.5 hours on the website, actually didn't talk to anybody, put the credit card and paid us $38 per month. Today he's still paying $330, I think they're still the customer. But I've sold to customers in Australia or Belgium or Brussels or New York without meeting them. Sometimes via email, sometimes via phone call. But if I have a customer in Chennai or Bangalore, they will immediately call and say, "Ni Chennai thana iruka? Why don't you come over?" See, $100 la varum illa boss. So see, how can I come to Bangalore or Delhi and take a flight or train and go and meet him, and at the end of the day, if you're going to pay me, my business model doesn't allow me to travel, stay in a hotel and do the sales, right? So I have to do it online. So the coming back to the lesson is, first you have to build a product which strangers are willing to open their wallet and pay money. Before that, don't worry about global. So that, I'm saying this because a lot of times I've seen startup entrepreneurs who build something. They will say, "I have 6 customers or 12 customers." Okay, the 6 customers separate badal. So their previous employer will be one customer, their sister concern will be another customer, and then somebody who invested in the money, that person will be a customer. So then one of their relatives will be working for Airtel or HSBC or HDFC Bank. They would have bought something. They are one customer. All of these don't count. Okay, you can get the money, keep it in the bank, but you have still not built a product. So a product, this is what people call as product market fit, right? Whatever you have built, you have to be able to get somebody who's not known to you, who's not thinking that, "Hey, let me do this Jagannathan a favor." I don't know if there's a Jagannathan in the room, I'm just saying. In general, like, people should not think they're doing you a favor. They are actually buying the product on the value of the product. So that is number one. So you need to have product market fit. And when multiple customers are paying you, you know that you have something which is working in the market. Now the second thing is, if you want to really scale big, right? So market is a very big factor. So if you are playing in a big market, it is possible to get a smaller portion. If you are choosing a very niche small market, you better be the only player there, right? Meaning you have to have a monopoly advantage. Both are possible, viable. If you are vertical, then there is a different approach. The result is different. But just to come back to this original question, number one, you have to have a product market fit. Number two is, if you are competing against global software companies, you need to invest in global talent. Right? Meaning global talent as in people in Chennai or Bangalore or wherever, who you don't compromise on talent, is what I mean. So, because at the end of the day, your salesperson is pitching against the Salesforce salesperson or Zendesk salesperson. Your support person is competing against another support person from San Francisco. Your designer has to produce design that is comparable or better. Nobody, so you don't want to have like a compromise on the quality of people. So set the bar high. This is a mistake I have seen which people, startups do again and again and again, because you can't attract talent, right? That's why I always say, if you can't get a Sachin, get a Rahane or a Kedar Jadhav or whoever, which means a young person today can do as much as a experienced person. So a lot of times we want experienced folks, but you're not able to attract, they don't want to join this small startup. So, but you need to get a good talent. The third aspect is, do you have a repeatable model? So how do we, do you know how to generate leads again and again, how to build pipeline?
Now,
couple of things, you know, you mentioned in our conversations. One is
that you said that many entrepreneurs get too emotionally attached to their product, and you have always advocated a detachment in one sense. But at the same time, people say, look, man, I'm an entrepreneur. If I'm not passionate, people say, show passion, fire in the belly, all this business, okay? How do you explain this contradiction in one sense?
It's interesting. I was talking to somebody before coming here on the same topic. See, I always say, don't confuse passion and emotion, right? Every entrepreneur, or even you need employees who are passionate. As an entrepreneur, you need to be passionate. But being emotional blinds your clarity of thought. And I'll give you an example from my own product. So on October 11th or 9th, we are going to launch a new UI experience for Freshdesk. So last year, one of my pre-sales folks came and made a presentation, and in which he had a customer quote which said, Freshdesk UI is so 2010. Okay, now, it was shocking for me to hear, because as an entrepreneur, I know that our UI was one of the main reasons why customers loved our product. In 2011 and 12, if you go to Google Ads Marketplace, you will see again and again review after review, people would say, oh, this is like a breath of fresh air, or this is so intuitive, and everything is where it needs to be. So this is the strength in which our product was. So if I was emotional about it, I would not see the reality. So being able to detach yourself, not only in product or entrepreneurship, but in life also, when you're able to detach yourself from your problems or from your emotions and see, look at the problem from a other person's point of view and actually consider, like, does he have a point? Maybe what he's saying is true. When you look at it like that, then I can clearly see, yeah, what he's saying is true. Our UI is so 2010, the world has moved to a new style. We are still in the tired old style, so we need to start working. So we spent 8-9 months on this. So I think that is my lesson in life. Not only in entrepreneurship, is how do you learn to be passionate, but don't be emotionally attached to whatever you do. Only then you will be able to detach and see it as it is.
So, karmanya vadhikaraste kind of approach. Okay, one of the things, being an investor yourself, okay, now I'll come to this very interesting thing about Girish. Girish has three ways in which he gets linked or sort of engaged with entrepreneurs. One, he gives a lot of time per chapter, is getting less of it now, in mentoring and mentorship. A lot of people, there are a lot of people who owe it to Girish, and he in turn owes it to people like Kumar and all that. So one is mentoring and mentorship. The second is he's an investor. So he's invested in quite a few companies. In fact, he's got a pretty good record as an investor, that when he brings a deal, other members of a network and all automatically kind of look at it very seriously. And the third thing, which is very interesting for you, okay, is that he'll acquire. August, he acquired 9th company. In a period of just 2 years, 9 companies are acquired. Now, one of the things you mentioned as an investor, that there are 4 things that you look for in a startup. One, product, and obviously you mean the product market fit. Second, you look at market, which is the size of the market, etc. Third, you look at the team and how they're aligned. And number 4, you look at traction. Can you just tell these people, how many here are funded by any strength? Anybody got funded? Has been funded? Anybody wants to get funded? Okay, at least some few hands. So, can you just explain?
There is a fight also now, fifth point also. So, see, I think I'll start with what's the most important for VCs, okay? See, because if you're an angel investor like Chandu also, your investments will be successful only when, see, market is the most important thing. If the market itself is small, there is no way your company is going to really become big, like a billion-dollar business. So, a lot of times what you need to do, especially if you have already started, you need to think about how can you expand the market. See, this is why people go through pivots. Like, maybe your core technology is your IP. You have chosen a very niche market, but maybe you can make some changes and choose a broader market. So, the bigger the market, the better your chances of funding. Like, think of it as a 20% weightage, right? The second thing is, for me personally, is the product. So, and that's a bias. So there are some investors who are okay with execution, because in monopoly markets, you can get away with a lousy product. or not so great product, and I won't say lousy, but because there's no other choice, in a heavily competitive segment like where we play horizontal, then a great product is the differentiator without which you can't win. So my bias for product comes from that. So traction again is basically, have you demonstrated the ability? I already talked about this, like for strangers to pay you, because traction is the only way to prove to a neutral investor that you have something that is working. See, you can come and you can be present yourself really well, you can have a fancy degree, IIT, IIM, and you can actually have a great idea and pitch all of that, but if nobody has bought it, there are no users, and if you come and say, give me 2 crores, and then I will use that money for marketing, and then I will acquire the customer, most investors feel that it's very risky. So they want to see some proof of success. Once you have some proof of success, and today you also have to understand that it is possible. Most companies that are getting funded with some initial traction. There are only very few which are getting funded on the track record of the founder or on some other parameter of the idea, maybe the strength of the idea, etc. But it's very hard to raise funding on an idea. So you have to show good traction, and also it's important to go to market or go fundraising at the right time. If you wait too long, and let's say you have spent 6 years and you have say $5,000 of revenue, then how will you go to fundraise now and say in the next 2 years I'm going to get $2 million revenue? So unless something has changed, whether you're going to a new market or you've released a new product and suddenly you're hitting traction, so the right timing to go is when things are looking up. People call it the hockey stick effect, right? Like, say you should have at least 3-4 months of a good solid momentum. That's the right time to go and talk to investors and make sure that you also have the next 3-4 months also continuing the momentum, or at least hopefully it should continue forever. But if you're going for fundraise, people will be talking to you and watching every month, so you need to make sure momentum doesn't slow down. So we talked about market, product, traction, team. So again, as I told you, you need to have a well-rounded team, because nobody can, so there are usually startup teams are one-sided. So you may have a tech-heavy person who doesn't have a design co-founder or doesn't have a business person. So it will obviously show in the product and show in the business. So, and you have to first understand that you may be a maverick, but nobody can be, Sachin Tendulkar cannot be your mainstay wicketkeeper and bowler. Right? That it's very common sense in cricket, but if you actually think about all of the startups, you will find obvious gaps. You may be going to a match, a world class match without a wicketkeeper, or you're going with very poor fielders, or you're going without sales guys, right? So without bowlers. So how do you expect to win? So that is team. The fifth point I will add is, today it's also very important, is the founder. See, today we know that the DNA of the founder is the DNA of the org. So if you have a jerk or an idiot, then it's going to amplify, right? And also what investors look for is, hey, is this guy capable of building this business big? That is very, very important, because see, if you have a very young founder, see, building a company requires going through a lot of emotional turmoil. You have to attract so much of talent. Will people join this person, or does he have the ability to learn things that he does not know? Is he coachable, right? So, or is he or she coachable? So that is one question which investors look for. Okay, today is okay, like, but is this person capable of building a big business by themselves?
Fantastic. So now I'm getting into the next question, you know, which is a neat segue from where you came, which is the DNA of the founder. There are three words people talk about. You've heard funders also talk about this, which is the word called strategy, you know, broadly articulated in some of these aspects that you mentioned. The second is execution. Strategy is nonsense. Everything is really about execution. But the new thing people talk about is culture, which you talked about, the DNA. And people say culture eats strategy for lunch. As you've grown so rapidly in the last 6 odd years, in your mind, what is really playing, what kind of key role at what point in time, and what are the lessons you have taken over the last few years?
Okay, See, I think broadly all three are important, but I think my understanding of the question is what takes precedence at which stage,
yes.
Right? So, see, I think when you're really small, culture, you don't have to do any work. Basically, the founder DNA is the culture, and the people you are attracting, I'm saying when a company is, say, less than 20 people or 30 people, culture is, or even 50, culture is just manageable. You don't have to do any specific work on culture. You just need to have some, and all of us have some beliefs, right? So some companies may have, which is, according to me, is a bad culture where you actually say people have to come to office at 9 o'clock, people have to stay till 6 o'clock. So these are all, in today's millennial workforce, warming the benches is not going to get the job done. So there may be trust, like in our culture, we trust by default. There may be companies where trust is not there by default, like you may have to cut internet access and so on. So culture is basically the set of do's and don'ts, like what will be appreciated in your company and what will be frowned upon in your company. You don't have to worry too much about culture, or at least I won't say worry, but you don't have to do a lot of stuff in the early days. It is very obvious, if somebody is not a fit, you will, as a CEO, immediately deal with it, meaning you may let the person go, etc. So I would say in the early days, even you can get away without a big strategy, because you are trying to get some traction, right? You don't need a lot. So execution is the most important, I would call the 0 to 1 million. According to, in my experience, like getting a product from 0 to 1 million, we have done it so many times, where you don't need broad, meaning you need some strategy, but you need more execution to make sure all the loose ends are tied up, and perfecting a painting, right? So all it has to be pixel perfect and so on. So a lot of this is execution, but I think as the company scales, like that's when strategy and culture both become really playing a big role. Because first, number one, as a founder, you start losing control of what's happening. Like you don't know everybody who's coming in the company. So today I was going to our lunch hall. The first 2-3 rows of people sitting, I was just watching and I knew nobody. Right? So we have grown. So we have grown to more than 1,000 people now. So now culture becomes a very important part, because like as the CEO, you cannot manage people, you have to manage culture. So when you manage culture and you incorporate, you do a lot of work to define what is your culture, you make sure that hiring processes are taking care of hiring the right culture fit, then your company has a lot of people who are culturally fit, then they will help identify the bad culture fits which can be dealt with quickly. Same way, without strategy, you cannot scale fast. Like what happens is, as a VC funded company, again I'm talking from our own perspective, so we call ourselves an accelerated tiger, because Axel and Tiger are both investors, right? So literally it's like catching the tail of a tiger, right? So we have to keep growing fast, and as a VC fund company, we have to, the faster we grow, the better our valuation and our IPO chances will be. So if you want to kind of make sure that your growth happens, that's where the broader strategy, the plan comes in, and that's where the MBA comes in. Again, I'll tell you this another interesting observation. Like a lot of times people will say MBAs are useless, right? Because entrepreneurship is a lot about creativity, and most of the time the startup founders are not MBAs, etc. So, but it's not like that's a very opinionated statement. What happens is MBAs come very useful in scaling what's really working well. Entrepreneurs are very good in the 0 to 1 problem. So basically cracking something that's never been done is a very good entrepreneurial trait. But once something is working, how do you go from 5 million to 50 million? The MBAs can really come and help you there. So I think in the scale-up phase, strategy and culture start to play a very well.
How many here in this room are more than, say,
20 crores in revenue? Okay, we have one. Okay. So most of you are below 20 crores? Okay. So one question I have for you, which is, how does an entrepreneur who's starting off or who's still small actually think big? feel big and then act big, because we are talking about dream dare too. And you've done this in 7 years, 6-7 years. What is the mental transformation or the mental mindset that's required to get there? I think personally, first it's a mind game. But I want to hear from you and your lessons.
Yeah. So I think, again, speaking from my experience, I think the most important lesson for me is we are all constrained only by our mind. So whenever I go to San Francisco, this is what happens, right? So you see, okay, Uber is in the news for all the wrong reasons, but think about the audacity of the plan, right? Starting a taxi company that can be in every city in the world. Now, how can somebody think like that? Think about, look at Mark Benioff. When I go to Dreamforce and attend his conference, you can see the scale of thinking. But what I see in a lot of Indian entrepreneurs, including like when through my journey, like we are all conservative. We don't dare, right? So we don't think big. So I've also seen entrepreneurs who say, hey, this year we'll grow 25%, and they're happy with it, right? But we are not thinking. Somewhere it comes into our mind that 25% growth is good, right? We are not thinking, how can I grow 200%, right? So, and it is possible. So in our case, what happened was, it happened by, like in many things in my life, it happened by trial and error, right? So I'll probably tell you one thing. When we first raised money from Axel, we were only making $2,000 of revenue, but we had 70 customers from all around the world. So later on I asked Axel, like when we were only $2,000 in revenue, how did you give me $1 million? I was surprised myself, like why would somebody give me $1 million in their $2,000 monthly revenue? So what Shekhar Kirani, our board member, told me was, see Girish, with you, we did not have the market risk. We only had execution risk. Because 70 customers from different parts of the world had paid you money, we knew that this can scale. So that was number one. So what he asked me in 2011, where will the revenue be at the end of 2012, right? And this is when we were $2,000. So I thought, okay, any product manager, for me, according to me, if I have to call a product a successful product, it has to be $1 million revenue. Otherwise, there's no point in doing all of this for me. So we have to think, 1 million could have been, how can it become a world-class product? Or so become a product manager, so it's a shame. So I told him, we will be at $1 million. Okay, it was like blurted out. Actually speaking, this is where I think the power of believing something, right? Then I started to think, how can we get to $1 million? So we missed by 1 month. Instead of December 2012, in January 2013, we hit $1 million. And the same story repeated again and again through different sources. So we had not planned for 2013. We were growing. We had just hit $1 million. Right? If I had told 2 million or 2.5 million, everybody would have been happy. I think something happened in February of 2013. I went to Bangalore for a hackathon. So Bessemer Venture Partners had put a hackathon. So they were investors in SendGrid and Twilio. How many of you know SendGrid and Twilio? Okay. So they were considering investing in us. So I talked to them and said, hey, tell me about SendGrid and Twilio. How did they grow, etc. So they said, I asked about the past early year trajectory. So they said, SendGrid went from some 1 million to 5 million, or Twilio went from 1.5 to 6 million or 5.5, and then next year was 16 and so on. So that was aspirational for me. So I always believed we should be like a Silicon Valley company. So somewhere somebody has to set the benchmark. So I thought, okay, let's set that as the benchmark. It was subconsciously happening in my mind. By April 2013, I started talking to my team members. So I thought, and at that time we were only like 1.4, or I don't remember the exact number, but so we said 5 million. Nobody believed. We had a sales consultant from Bangalore who was trying to coach. Like, he was like shocked also. Like, he said, from 1 million, how can you have to be more realistic? So I said, no, this is other companies have done it. We should try and do it, right? So by December 2013, we hit 5 million. So by 2014, there was an article that I read. You can Google it. It's called The SaaS Adventure. So I think somebody, I don't know when I read it, but somebody had written, the SaaS adventure is triple, triple, double, double, double. They analyzed all the public SaaS companies. They went from, like, the first phase will be somehow get from 0 to 2 million in annual recurring revenue. Once you get to 2 million, the next year, next 12 months, you have to get to 6 million. The next year, you have to get to 18 million. After that you double. So 2 to 6 triple, 6 to 18 triple, and then you double to 36, double to 72, double to 144. Now this is annual recurring revenue. If you are at 144 annual recurring revenue, you have crossed $100 million of GAAP revenue, by which time you can become a $1 billion company, like in the IPO if you're going. So now this was the new benchmark. So we said that triple, triple, double, double, double is the goal. So I think it's fair to say we are on that trajectory. So I will also tell you the revenue numbers that you said you have crossed $100 million.
So, you know, I'm going to ask the audience the one or two other questions, but Girish has already covered them. If you have any questions, just please put up your hand. Please put up your hand and I will moderate the question and all that. Please make it a direct question, okay? If you have any questions, please feel free to raise. Yeah.
Why started at cricket?
So, okay, question is why did you start in Kirkatle, right? And most people, how many of you know where Kirkatle is?
Adjacent to my area.
No. Many people in Chennai don't know, right? Chandu doesn't know. So, I was living in Pallikaranai. So, I always don't believe in wasting time in commute. So, I was looking at office space somewhere up to Velachery or OMR or whatever. So, we came up to this place also, I told you that. So, in 2010, we did not have these co-working spaces. None existed. Right? Today you have work and stay and so on. So, and I didn't want to go into a residential apartment and take it on rent because you will have the association problem and car park. See, we were six people, but we had four cars. So, in an apartment, you can't park four cars. So, we didn't want to go into a residential flat. So, we wanted a commercial space. I will tell you, there was millions of square feet vacant in Chennai, in all the OMR IT parks in 2011. But nobody would give you 1,000 square feet, 2,000 square feet extra. They were minimum will be like, you have to take a big thing. So we found out, so first office was actually not Kirkatle Lane. First office was inside Shekhar Vembo's office, called Zos, he was brother. So we rented a conference room and stayed there for 2 months. And we found this Kirkatle Lane. It was a warehouse. There were three rooms. One office was an interior designer. The other one was AC ducting storage material. So we found a 700 square foot rectangle with a attached restroom, right? So we actually did some wooden flooring and painted the walls with green and yellow for fresh dust. So that's how we went to Kirkatle because the road access was good. We could reach home to office in like 15-20 minutes. And the rent was 7,000 rupees. That's what we didn't want to waste too much money. We didn't have a lot of money also. So this and this was the reason for choosing Kirkatle because I didn't want to go to Nungambakkam or Adyar. It will every day commute will be like too much.
Thank you.
I have one more question. I'll just ask him one question. See, one of the things that we have seen with entrepreneurs when they get funded is that they think they've arrived. That funding causes a certain delusion. How over this journey of 102 years?
See, I think you have to understand at the end of the day, the responsibility of the CEO is to create value for all the stakeholders. So we have seen some bad examples in India where entrepreneurs have only taken care of themselves with the VC funding. So the investors have lost money or employees' careers were lost and stock options were lost. So I think somewhere fundamentally I've always taken, that's a responsibility of every entrepreneur or CEO that you create wealth for people who have invested in you, right? So which means, okay, you have to create wealth for yourself. You also have to create wealth for people who have invested in you and return the money with in a good ROI, and you have to create wealth for the people who have built this company along with you. So I think if you understand that, then you know funding is a tool which helps you build the value to make sure that you are doing it for everybody. So I think that's a very simple, I would be surprised, you should actually ask the question to others who are not following this. In my opinion, this is the right way, this is what, and I will also tell you, we are all living in an era where we are beneficiaries of a macro trend where interest rates in global markets are very, very low. lot of money is being printed. There is no good place for the money to go. That is why it is coming into entrepreneurship. If the US raises the interest rate by 1 or 2%, all the money will be sucked back. There will be no funding. Most of the money will go away. So we have to understand that in places like Japan or US, interest is not yielding any return, right? People cannot put their money in savings bank account and earn 1% or 1.5%, 2% interest. That is why all this money, even Canadian pension funds money is coming in. So a lot of money is coming in with the hope that they can invest in good value companies that create good value and get ROI. So that is a phenomenal opportunity for Indian entrepreneurs also, right? And if we realize the opportunity and build value, then everybody benefits. If we think, let's enrich ourselves at the cost of funding, then it's, I think it's a difference between an educated crook and a normal thief.
One of the things that Girish has mentioned is that
he wants every employee in his company to have a BMW. Said this publicly. Okay, this is what I think is the benefit of the democratization of entrepreneurship and letting the benefits go down. Now, you had a question, sir, over there.
Yeah. So thinking about your 2011-2012,
what are some of tips? Some of the tips for recruiting talent here? In such early stages, it's probably very hard to do that.
So, see, I think every entrepreneur, the successful ones that I know, tap into their networks. So in my case, I had worked for 10 years in Chennai. So I had a network of people who had worked with me, who knew me, etc. If you look at Flipkart or Ola or Zomato, they are all IIT alumnus. So they actually go and hire from IIT because they knew the people and the smart students would join them because they knew them as seniors, etc. Now we have some people from Flip, which is a company that we acquired. So Flip was founded by CEG, University Engineering, College of Engineering, Guindy folks. So they went and hired a lot of CEG folks from other companies. So I think one of the best things that works is, in the early days, you need people who will believe your stories. That is the truth. If the first 5, 6, 10 employees are going to be strangers, it's very, very hard for an entrepreneur to attract good talent, right? See, basically you should know that these are people who are really good and they are coming for you. They are believing in you, they are betting on you, they are hoping that you will take them along on a good ride. If you can't convince even 5 or 6 people, if you can't build the initial core team to demonstrate traction, to build that product, then what will happen is you will be forced to hire some freshers who can't get a job anywhere else. They are joining you because they don't have a choice. Now that is a very, very hard way to build a business. So because the quality of the initial talent, that's very critical. That is one of the lessons I would say which worked for me, which I've also observed from other entrepreneurs. The second thing I would say is a lesson is, you have to understand that if you are successful and the company scales, the organization will require very different kind of people. So do not make the mistake of making your first engineer as the CTO, your first salesperson as the VP of sales. So you need to understand that titles should not be thrown out as if to just make people important, right? So because before you know it, the company will grow big and then you will have a problem both for the person as well as for you. Meaning, because you know that if this person is a VP of sales, you cannot build a sales team under them because he's got 2 years experience and he's actually an okay salesperson. So, and so you're actually doing a disservice to both the employee and to your own company by throwing these fancy titles at a very early stage. So you need to understand that we all want to be successful. If we are successful, the kind of person, the kind of talent that we're able to attract will also change. The kind of role that this person will be able to play. See, the company's ability to scale is much faster than the employee's ability to scale. This is a natural function. The company can scale quickly because you have money, you can hire 100%, but an employee cannot overnight become somebody else. And this is, you have to have these conversations with employees. So you have to tell them, give them the role that is aspirational enough for them, it's playing to their strength, and give them the title that's appropriate with it. So people have to feel happy about that. So That is another learning that I had. And I've seen startups make those mistakes. Like you hire a salesperson, make them COO or VP of sales, and then you're stuck. You can't attract more talent, right? So, third point I would make is, in the early days of the startups, you will need a lot of generalists, people who can wear multiple hats and do it. As the company grows, you will need a lot of specialists. So, and sometimes you will find that some of your early leaders or early employees are able to scale into a leadership role where they respect these specialists. Sometimes you will find people who can't scale. So they will think, I was doing all of these 10 things myself. Now we have like 6 people and they are doing less than what I used to do. Now, it's the hard problem. You have to find a new role. Maybe like what we do is, in a new product, I'll put those generalists because they will feel happy there. Because in a larger product, you cannot operate like early days. Right? There has to be some discipline, some repeatable stuff. There are people who enjoy chaos. There are people who enjoy structure. So you need to know who enjoys what. I don't know why Nivas is laughing.
Okay, I think we had one question, but I just want to give a couple of instances. He recently hired, like he talked about a specialist position, he recently hired a chief revenue officer.
Chief
revenue officer, very high flying type of person. He also took a person from, you know, very leading companies. The other thing which is interesting is, one of his early investors in the 3F category, was on Mr. Rajshekar, who gave him some 20,000 rupees, $25,000, sorry, and who today continues to work for him in a sales position in the US. Correct?
Customer implementation
in the US. So, don't ask how much that $25,000 is worth right now, but that's a different story. Now, you had a question somewhere there? Yes.
In the initial stages of your startup, when do you know that you have enough traction to go and raise money? Because you have $10,000 per month revenue and $10,000 per month revenue, and you want to make, okay, can we go for $12,000 or $14,000? Then we have a nice story. So is there a benchmark or something like that?
See, that's a good question. So when is the right time to raise funding? So the first question before that is, should you raise funding or no? That in B2B, there is always space for 3 or 4 players. So the investors who missed out on one of the category players will always look for the others. So if I had not taken funding, somebody else would have been funded and they will grow. And especially in a competitive market where the parity in features is very, very less. Usually the guy with more money will actually win, right? So that was the, I'll take an example of Freshdesk, where if we had not raised money, some other help desk company would have raised money and taken the lead. Whereas there's a company, my favorite company, so a good friend of mine called BrowserStack. So they did not need any money because they were able to sell the product without any competition and generate profits. So they were bootstrapped. Till now, they have a very successful business without actually raising any money. So there are another company which I like is Visual Website Optimizer, which is Winkify. Again, bootstrapped to millions of dollars of revenue because they invented the category of A/B testing software, right? So that is the framework. When you don't have a lot of funded competitors and you have a niche market that you can own, then you can bootstrap and grow profitably and slowly. But if you are in a category where your competition is funded, then you also better take funding and move fast and see. But whenever you take funding, you have to understand, this is what I told my team. This is like rocket fuel. Either we'll take off and go, or we'll fall in Bay of Bengal. Right? So you have to be okay to do that. Now the second question is, or our actual question is, when is the right time to get funded? So I would say, as early as possible, if there is somebody willing to fund. Right? So which means, if everything goes well, that is. So if you have very little runway, it's better to start the talks earlier.
Nobody else with a question. Okay. Now, one of the things.
Yes, sir.
Right. I'll. Okay. Your question?
Yeah. Myself, money. I just want to understand, we are a startup actually. How important is the financial department in a new startup company? Because mostly the founders and co-founders will be either technical or business side. I just want to understand what is your experience.
See, I think we also were like, we are still a startup, but we also did not have a financial co-founder. But I think, I will tell you, after doing 9 acquisitions, I tell you, it is important to keep the house clean. Okay, either you hire an employee or you can find somebody as a consultant to help you. Make sure your accounts are clean. Don't do the Indian business thing of trying to buy your own personal car with the company money. If it's a lifestyle business, you can do all of that. If you really want to build a scalable, fundable business, then keep the business clean, keep the books clean. Make sure compliances are taken care of. If you're sending money abroad or receiving money abroad, RBI clearance, the FCGPR certification, so all of that will later on come back and haunt you. If somebody is willing to acquire you, if all this is not done, it will take like 6 months, 8 months to finish this process. RBI will take its own sweet time if you have not done it on time. So I would say you don't need strategic finance. All those things don't matter because you are still in the process of building a product and trying to get product market fit. So hiring a VP of finance or a CFO and all is a waste of time and money at that point of time. Just get some help, either through, and usually you can find some auditor's friend or relative that you have can come and do this basic housekeeping and keeping everything in order. That's what is important. Make sure compliance taken care.
One of the things our good friend Mithun talks about is the tyranny of the pink press, which is the business dailies. They all talk about these startups, and especially if you are seen as a kind of a rising star, there's a lot of buzz. Okay, so you come in the news very often. There are two aspects to it. One is allowing that to get your head. A. B. Many times negative stuff also happens, social media, etc. As a founder, whether today social media especially is very terrible. So how do you manage to deal with all this nonsense that's happening, good things and bad things? Secondly, this loneliness of being a founder, how do you cope with it, and how have you found managing mechanisms for it?
See, I'll tell you one, again, playing back on my emotions, right? See, it is really, it gives you a kick, right? When you see covered in Economic Times or Times of India, so everybody calls you and congratulates you, you post on Facebook, you have 1,000 likes or 500 likes. So all of this really makes you feel as if it's suddenly you've got some power, right? And when you look at the news, see, we have been fortunate enough till now, that we not had any major negative news. But when you look at companies that were celebrated in 2014 and 15, were completely destroyed in 16 and 17. So it gives you a reality check. So I always tell some of my employees that, hey, this is in media, as a fast funded startup, you can go from darling to donkey in 6 months. See, today we may be the darling of the media, right? Because everything is going well, they just want news. If something bad happens, they will say this news for them, right? So we have to make sure that we don't let that get into us. We should not be like seeking this media attention, and also learning to live with both. So I think one of my favorite lines is from Rudyard Kipling's If poem, right? So success and failure, like if you can treat those two imposters just the same, so that's when you become a true man, right? I think this is a great line which all of us can learn from. So we can learn from superstar Rajni also, right? Success and
failure. Coming to that.
So I think it's hard, but it's very important. And the other question you asked was loneliness as a founder. So I think, at the end of the day, I've not faced in the initial 2-3 years, there was no major disaster or times when I needed this counseling. But I think Shekhar, our investor and board member, has been a good sounding board. So sometimes as an entrepreneur, there are things that you can't tell your employees, there are things that you can't tell your investors, and you may need a support system. So we have now a group of friends. So the best support system for entrepreneurs, other entrepreneurs, where you can all maybe have a beer and talk about your woes. So that's what we do. So I think that is fundamentally, that's one of the reasons why all these ecosystems create these events where people hang around with each other and learn from each other. Is we all need that drawing of energy from each other, because when you go back, and the best place to actually see this is Amway, right? And like 10, 12, 15 years ago, I went to an Amway meeting, a big one. So you could actually see the Amway business is a very negative business. When you go every day and try to sell, no, everybody will say no, no, no. But then everybody comes together and then they celebrate everybody, right? So the energy in that room will be so much. I think entrepreneurs, even though Amway is something which we may not like doing, but entrepreneurship is definitely something we love doing. This event of meeting other people, learning from their experiences, the drawing of energy from each other, that's the best support system.
That gives me an opportunity to sell Taikon 2017. If you have other entrepreneur friends who have not registered for Taikon 2017, please do so. The second early bird offer is closing in a few days from now. Second, there is something called Thai Sunday this time, which we are having for our members and to some extent for non-members. 25,000, you can display your wares and offerings for 2 days in front of an audience which wants people like you. 25,000, the two men to talk to are sitting right here. Book your stall now. Okay, now the next question, please.
So in a bootstrapped startup, you know, you have a small team and many of them are very critical, hard to replace. And most of these people, you can't pay them what the market pays either, right? And many of these people have their own aspirations and stuff. And you know, at that point in time, stock options may not even make any sense. So what are some of the strategies that you found successful to, you know, ensure their loyalty, their long-term partnership with you?
See, you have to believe that stock options will make sense. And it has made sense in our case, right? See, there are only two currencies that you have. One is the Indian rupee, the other is your own stock. As an entrepreneur, where in the early days, we had more stock currency and less cash currency. Now we have more cash currency and less stock currency. The package that we always did was based as a combination of the two. I'll tell you some examples, right? So there are people who were working in Bangalore who had worked with me earlier, so now they are coming back. So they were making 10 lakhs in Bangalore. So when I hired them, I wanted to pay them 14 lakhs. But the offer was, you can either take 9 lakhs in cash and 5 lakhs in stock, or 10 lakhs in cash and 4 lakhs in stock, or 11 lakhs in cash and 3 lakhs in stock. The choice was the employee. So people who took that, it's a multiplied 80 times to 100 times now. Right? So I'll also tell you, today Freshdesk employees own $90 million worth of stock in the last round's valuation, which was last year. So it has to make sense. That is why the people who are coming should come. Meaning, and now there are people available like that. Meaning, earlier people did not understand the value of stock. Now there are enough employees who have seen the value of stock. They have worked in other startups. They have made money. So they know that stock is the only way to create wealth. At the end of the day, if you only have salary and home loan, that's not my father, my uncle. Nobody became rich with salary and home loan, right? So that's when I decided that we have to do something else. We have to kind of create that stock as the wealth. And that, when I told my wife really in 2010, I'm not starting this company for me to buy a BMW, I'm starting this company for all my employees to buy a BMW, because that is the way you create wealth. Many people have done this before us, but somehow we have gone into this owner mindset where, okay, entrepreneurs or founders should own all the stock 100% or 51% or 80% control, and treating employees as not owners. That will never create the magic of, see, when once you give stock, the employee's mind transforms. It's now their business. They are owners, right? And when they feel they are owners, the way they work is completely different. So I think it's important to create and share that wealth. And at the end of the day, everybody understands that if you're not growing, these subs are worthless. But we have to demonstrate that growth and create the division. So between 2006 and 2010, I was able to see the Zoho division, the SaaS division grow. IT division also was growing, but you have to understand where is the bet. So if cloud computing is going to take off, it means companies will have fewer and fewer IT departments, right? So the bigger bet on SaaS, if you're a hospital, I'm telling you, why do you want to run your own IT department? I can serve the application to you via browser. Now, in 1900, there's a book called Big Switch. You should read that by Nicholas Carr. So basically, the question is, in 1900, all the factories used to run their own power plants. And then suddenly somebody gave power off the grid, like the electricity board. So companies started buying power, paying 1 rupee 50 paise per unit, something like that, right? So it suddenly made sense for them. I am running a factory, I need power, but I don't need to run my own power plant. Now if you think about IT department, that's what is happening today. A bank or a hospital or a lawyer's office, they're all running IT departments because they need computers and they need applications. Now SaaS is like electricity. Now the software is coming off the grid, off the cloud. So why do you need to run an IT department? This is the big switch. So when this big switch is happening, then you have to remember, now I ask myself the question, what am I doing heading the IT management division of the company? Because the big switch is in SaaS, so this is the right wave is happening. So let me ride the wave. Also, probably after spending almost close to 10 years at Zoho, I went to the US for 1.5 years and came back. So most of my teams were in auto mode. I was getting a little bit restless. I was like a management guy. I used to be called into meetings day in, day out. Today also that's what is happening, but I did not like it. Meaning I want to be hands-on, build product, that's what I enjoyed. I did not enjoy going into meeting after meeting and resolving conflict, and it was getting a little bit boring. So I thought, okay, let me try to do something. I spent 10 years, and so I also knew, see, there was no stock option, which is never promised, never given. So you have to finally figure out that at the end of the day, you have to do something for yourself. I have told many of my employees in my previous company that what you're getting here is valuable education, and at some point of time, you can use the education, like an MBA. An MBA in ISB costs 22 lakhs. So I had an MBA building products, right, building businesses. So at some point in time, you had to use that MBA to kind of earn for yourself. So that's when I decided, okay, I have valuable education in having built multiple products and taking them to successful millions of dollars. So let me do it for this. That was how I started.
Kirish, first of all, congratulations on whatever you have achieved so far. We feel happy to see you, feel a person who's building a $1 million company. So that's something that we are very proud of. And coming from Chennai, we are happy that you hear your name at many places. So congratulations. And
thank you.
First, I have two questions, Kirish. One is, till what revenue point should you depend upon inbound and digital marketing? Or is it, Chandru was saying about the 70 million that you have achieved. Do you still depend upon the inbound and digital marketing? That's my first question. And what's the percentage that you have right now? My second question would be, 5 years back, or when you started, there were 4 to 5 companies SaaS-based with 1 million ARR. Now we have around 50 companies. Is the space already crowded? Or is it something that we could do something? Or what do you think would be the space in the next 5 years? Will it be more vertical focus that's going to happen, or is it still going to be horizontal, sliver-based, inbound digital marketing? Is that what you think? So those are the two questions I have.
Okay. So for the first question, I think, I call it a sales model or a business model, right? So if you have a model that's working, there's no reason to stop it or change it. So when we started, we only had digital marketing and inbound lead generation. Today, because we can afford to hire salespeople in US and UK and Australia, we are doing what the US companies do, which is we hire salespeople and go to outbound also. So the ratio has changed from maybe 95% inbound to maybe around 75% inbound, and maybe next year it will become 65% inbound. So, but my answer is, you need not change. So it's like, my analogy of a business model or a lead gen model is like an engine. So if you have one engine which is powering your car or plane, well and good, go on that. If you can fire up a second engine and fly faster, why would you want to, if it's profitable and you can do it, make it work. We tried the outbound as an experiment. And when we knew that we can scale it, and it takes time to scale outbound. It's inbound, you can turn on the tap and know whether it's working or not. Outbound will take a year to 18 months to get everything rolling and scaling. So, but if you have the resources to do that, now we have multiple engines, right? So even our Land and expand is the third engine, the customer success. We're getting more revenue from existing customers. We have teams which actually work with our customers and then try to get more adoption and upsell into multiple products. Or so that is also another engine. So I think as a CEO, I like to have a lot of control. Each one of you should think about how many levers or engines and other dials can you push. Always keep two or three as wildcard, because when one engine falters, you need to push hard on the other so that you keep flying. And the second question was?
SaaS, already SaaS.
Yeah, so see, SaaS is not a market. Okay, you have to understand SaaS is a delivery model. Okay, the markets, the horizontal markets are help desk or network monitoring or project management or CRM or, so these are the marketing automation. So these are the horizontal categories. The vertical categories are healthcare, dental, etc. So the markets are all still existent. The markets are all still growing. Most of the markets are growing. Okay, so in the many of the markets, on-premise is being slowly taken out and SaaS is gaining. If the market is growing by itself, then you have a double advantage. Again, it's a market engine, right? So the market itself is growing faster and you can scale faster. And so when the market grows faster, you can get your share easier. If the market is shrinking, but you are the dominant player, you can still extract value. But you have to use the money to look at other market. So I think SaaS is never going to be concentrated. I mean, that's not a market.
Yes. Sir. If you had to hire some mentors or consultants, and you definitely cannot pay them cash, how are you evaluating them in terms of equities or how much equity you give? There would be different roles. Someone you could get for getting the funding, someone for marketing, or someone to consult you on the sales. So how do you go about doing the hiring them in terms of what?
My advice, if you haven't got any useful advice from the mentor, don't give them anything. There are enough good mentors. See, good mentors are some people who have already achieved to do it for free. This is a paid forward. All entrepreneurs do it. All the mentors who I have seen who take equity or a fee for mentorship, in my experience, have not been worth it. So it's a waste of money. So that's my. So you have to find people who have been there, done that, and they will, if you can find the time, they will help you. You have to be worth their time. I will also tell you other problem. Like, see, today, as much as I want to help, if I actually respond to every email and take every 15-minute, 10-minute request that come to me, I cannot run Freshworks. So that is the volume. I'm happy that so much entrepreneurship is happening, but I also have to realize that I have a business to run. See, Sachin Tendulkar has to realize that as long as he's batting, or Virat Kohli, has to realize that only when you're batting, the other value of mentorship is coming. If the advertisement revenue will come, right? If I stop playing, then that is gone. So that is the reality. So which means you also have to be mindful of the mentor's time. So as much as we all want to help, that's where the platform where we can do one-to-many helps. So one-to-one becomes hard for busy people who are operating now.
Mr. Shankar, the Thai president, had alluded to a platform that Thai Chennai has trying to formalize more and more for mentoring. You may want to keep in touch with the Thai secretariat and get more details.
That doesn't ask for equity or anything.
It asked for zero. Nobody asked for anything. Okay, yeah, you had the question.
I am Santosh, Girish. A lot of crystallized wisdom coming in from you. Many thanks, and we are very glad about it. Now, my one question is, I mean, see, we are building a product, obviously, that's why we are here. It's a SaaS-based product, and I think, I mean, we have made the market fit because we have paying customers coming in now. So what should be the priority now? Anyway, you have spoken about the funding part, where, at what point you need to look for the funding? I'm not touching that part. But what should be the priority now? Should I be focusing on the break-even now and be self-sustainable and scale, or should I in parallel start scaling? We haven't reached the same point now.
What is the second option?
No, break-even. Should we focus on the break-even rather than scaling, or scaling and the break-even, attempting to break-even, should go in parallel?
Do you have funds to scale without profitability?
No, not yet.
So do you have a choice in?
Scaling has to wait.
If you don't see, the Nano Rowdy Damari, so all of us are entrepreneurs till we have money in the bank. Okay, the moment the money runs out, we are no longer entrepreneurs, right? Meaning you have to. So that is the only risk you need to worry about. See, you can do, you can change your product, you can change your entire team, you can change your strategy. If you have money in the bank and you can keep working on it till the end of that money, you are an entrepreneur. So if you risk that and tomorrow you run out of money, doesn't matter how much customers you have, how much, if you can't pay salaries to your employees, you can't pay your vendors, they're not going to be in business. So if you want to scale without profitability, then get funds. If you don't have funds, you don't have a choice. And this is another important thing. A lot of times we assume that we have the choice. We don't have the choice. So one of my past employees actually came and told me, like, I think that was also in IIT or anything like that. So he had applied to the US, his visa got rejected. Now he's thinking he is quitting his job. And should he go for another job or should he go to US? I said, your visa is rejected, you're not going to US. There's no choice. He's just emotional, so he's just thinking that option is still there. Because somebody has given him a UST admit or whatever. So if there's no visa, there's, that option is not on the table. So again, entrepreneurs come to me and say, like somebody from Indonesia is talking about acquisition, they're talking about funding. Talk is cheap, right? Unless you have a term sheet, you don't have an option. So please do not worry about the option that you don't have. So that is the...
Okay, I'm going to end with a little lighter note. Girish is a major Rajnikanth fan. His office is full of stuff on Rajnikanth and all that. But that's not the interesting part alone. Girish, just tell us how you like to live life king size. Let the audience also get a sense of your attitude to life.
I don't know what answer you're expecting. So I will tell you, but I think probably he's referring to my car. See, I will also tell you other truth. He said papaya fruit, which most of you are still wondering why. I am a diabetic for 10 years, right? Not 12 years now. So I used to tell him, I think the last event I told him, see, in Trichy, in my house, we had like a huge garden with 5 mango trees and 8 coconut trees and papaya tree. We never touched the papaya, only monkeys eat the papaya. Like I used to eat 2 mangoes, right? And we don't cut the mango, we eat it fully. Like now that I'm a diabetic, I can't touch any of those fruits. So only papaya is allowed. So like that, so if I'm a diabetic, I have always said that, see, money is like a number in the bank, right? Or so I like to live and make use of today. See, my kids are 13 years and 11 years old. So I have only time with them till they go off to college or whatever. Then anyway, they're not going to listen to me after this. Even now, they're not listening. So whatever little time that I have with them, like I have to enjoy now. So in fact, I also like to use, see, I am not